my most recent book is looking at the impact of technology on jobs and the labor force, and really looking at the future of what's going to happen to our economy as it becomes more and more high-tech oriented. I gave an interview a few days ago to a media outlet, and afterwards the interviewer said, listening to you really scared me. So I apologize in advance if I scare you tonight. But I should say there are two chapters in my book about solutions and reforms and what we need to do in order to orient our economy in the right direction. So I try to balance looking with a very realist viewpoint at what's happening to the economy with what we ought to do. You know, I look at both the traditional economy as well as what's known as the sharing economy, what sometimes is called the gig economy, on-demand economy, peer-to-peer economy. There's all these names for it. And what it really is about is, you know, they have these websites and apps now where a seller of a service or a producer of goods can connect directly with the customer. And there's no middle person. You're just, you know, you're being connected directly. So that's why in some ways I think the best name for it is really peer-to-peer economy, but it is kind of a wonky sort of name. And but there's, you know, it's not, it all sounds so rosy, and the people who are really pushing this, the visionaries and gurus, so to speak, are will tell you that it's really a great thing. But, and there are some, definitely some, I think if we put the right regulations around a lot of this, there are some good that can come out of it, but there's some real problems with it now that we have a few years to look at how it works. So I'm looking at both the traditional economy and this sort of gig economy. In my book, you meet people, for example, from the traditional economy, like Chris Young, an auto worker in Tennessee. He works in a Nissan plant. And Chris works alongside a lot of other workers. Those workers are wearing the Nissan shirt because they work directly for Nissan. Chris doesn't get to wear the Nissan shirt because he doesn't work for Nissan. He works for a contractor. And as a contractor, even though he's doing the exact same job as everybody else, he's getting half the pay. He has no safety net. He has no job security to speak of. He can be let go at any time. He's what's known as a temp worker. And in fact, Chris has been working at this job as a temp for about 4 years. And so they have a new name for these sorts of workers, permatemps. How about that for using language in a way to obfuscate what's going on? Some of these permatemps have been working 5, 6, 7, the record I've seen is 11 years working as a temp worker. And in the aftermath of the Great Recession, about a fifth of the jobs that have been created, the new jobs, are temp jobs. So in the Great Recession, we lost a lot of the good jobs, as they're called, you know, that had benefits, decent wages, some degree of job security until the jobs just disappeared, and they're being replaced by a lot of these types of jobs. You also meet people like Jimmy Marina. Now, how many people have heard of Google buses and Facebook buses and all these sorts of things in the Bay Area? You know, it is quite astounding to see these Leviathans parking on the corner of you know, in the Mission District. And, you know, if you or I were to do what they do, you'd get a $250 ticket for blocking traffic. They just sit there, you know, and wait to fill up with tech workers and take them down into Silicon Valley. So we've heard a lot about these buses, but what we haven't heard about are the drivers of these buses. These drivers don't work for Google or Facebook. They work for a contractor. And again, they don't have any safety net, they don't have job security, and Jimmy Marina, he begins his day at 5:30 in the morning. He doesn't end until 9:30 at night. He doesn't get to see his children in the morning because he's gone before they get up. He doesn't get to see them at night because they're in bed by the time he gets home. To get around federal laws about how long your working day can be, the company makes Jimmy and his colleagues take about 4 hours off in the middle of the day. And they also don't allow them to get another job during that 4 hours. And a lot of these drivers live too far away to go home during those 4 hours. So they basically hang out in the parking lot, practically indentured servants to this job that has these sorts of requirements and doesn't really reward them very well. You also meet another type of worker in my book, Maria Fernandez. Maria Fernandez was a Dunkin' Donuts worker. She worked in New Jersey at a Dunkin' Donuts franchise, and in fact, she couldn't make it work financially for herself by working at one Dunkin' Donuts franchise, so she worked at three of them. You know, none of the franchises would give her enough hours because a lot of these companies, the way they work is they say if you work 25 or 30 hours, whatever, then you get benefits, right? So they just make sure everybody is under that threshold. So she couldn't make it work working at one of them, so she worked at three of them. She just drove up and down the Jersey Pike, working an overnight shift one time, a night shift another time, a day shift, just, you know, up and down, up and down. In order to make sure she didn't run out of gas, she kept a can of gas in her car. And she pulled into a Wawa convenience store parking lot about 5:30 in the morning one morning to get a little shut-eye before her next shift. No one knows quite what happened, but somehow that can of gas overturned, and she died of asphyxiation in her Dunkin' Donuts uniform in the car in the Wawa parking lot. Even as the CEO of Dunkin' Donuts was earning $12 million a year in salary and bonuses and all sorts of things. So these are the sorts of workers that you meet in my book. And you know, when she died, there was actually kind of it precipitated a national discussion about what's happening to jobs in the United States, that workers would have to work at three different jobs like this, three different part-time jobs in order to piece it together for themselves. You know, some people very sympathetic, others people saying, well, she was dumb. I mean, she shouldn't have kept a can of gas in her car. Anyone knows that that's not a smart idea. And, you know, there's maybe a degree of truth to that, but it missed the point that when you have workers that are operating at such an edge, at such a close margin that any small error can cause such tragic consequences, that's when we have to really think about what's happening to jobs, both the quality of jobs and the quantity of jobs. So now, into this context, and keep in mind, this is the context coming out of the Great Recession, in the middle of this so-called recovery. That's where we see this sharing gig on-demand economy plugging in. And this is being sold to us as the type of economy that we're all going to plug into eventually to one degree or another. The idea that, you know, you'd work for a company like Upwork or TaskRabbit or Uber or Airbnb in order to monetize your assets, as the gurus of the sharing economy like to call it. Monetizing your assets, meaning you'll rent out a room in your home, you'll use your car to become a taxi driver, you'll rent out some of your equipment that you have at home, your drill or photography equipment, and you'll rent those out to people, and that'll bring in some money, and you'll combine that with working part-time, maybe for a Dunkin' Donuts franchise, and maybe combine that with you know, some other form of work, maybe, you know, even under the table work. The idea that we're going to piece things all together, that there's this sort of just ethos around Silicon Valley, just a given that, you know, a lot of the good jobs are disappearing. Companies like Facebook, which, you know, they bought Instagram, which replaced Kodak. Kodak used to employ 50,000 people. Facebook employs about 10,000 people. Instagram even less. And so because they're able to use automation and algorithms and others to create high degrees of labor efficiency and productivity, they're able to do a lot more with a lot fewer workers. So there's going to be fewer jobs for us, and we're going to monetize our assets in order to make a living. This is the vision that is being put forward. You hear it coming from CEO after CEO, whether it's Travis Kalanick of Uber or Brian Chesky of Airbnb, the CEOs of Upwork and TaskRabbit, Leah Busk and others. Upwork is a rather interesting example of this company. Upwork is a labor brokerage. They have about 6 million freelancers on their platform, and those freelancers are people who do things like designing graphic logos, you know, computer specialists, data specialists who can design programs, computer programs. They can crunch numbers for you. There are lawyers on there who can write a legal brief for you. The key with them is that pretty much anybody who lives anywhere in the world can do this work, and they can just email you the product. They can Dropbox it for you. You know, they don't have to be near you geographically, in other words. And so you can see that, you know, on this platform, you go and you look, and there's the U.S. workers, and they're all saying, you know, I'd like to get paid about $40 to $50 an hour for what I do. And then there's the workers in Europe, you know, they're saying the same thing, Canada, Australia. And then there's the workers there from India, Thailand, Philippines, and they're saying, I want to get paid $2 to $3 per hour to do the same job. And they're very skilled in these places. You know, they've had great training in these places. So basically, workers in the United States are competing against workers in developing countries. And what you do is, you know, as an employer or a business who wants to hire one of these people, you post your job, and then the workers go and they all bid on this job. It's an auction. But it's not an auction in which the highest bid wins. It's an auction in which the lowest bid wins. It's just a race to the bottom. That's what these platforms are putting forward. Same with TaskRabbit and some of the other labor brokerages. They, you know, have similar dynamics built into their labor platforms. TaskRabbit is something where, you know, if you want to hire someone to put together your IKEA furniture or paint a fence or rake some leaves or pick up your prescriptions, you can do that by hiring people on the platform. Now, all these people who are working on these platforms, like a lot of the workers in the traditional economy, they're contractors. They're freelancers. So they're not getting any safety net. There's no job security. Wages can be quite low. Some of the workers are complaining that they're not even making minimum wage on these platforms. But there's also something really revolutionary and disruptive. I mean, the gurus of this sharing economy love that word disruption, that to them they wear that as a badge of honor. They believe that it's good to disrupt government regulation and to disrupt companies who have been around for a while and old models of business and such. So, you know, if you think about it, when you work at a job in the, you know, a regular employee job at the in the traditional economy, you report to work, and you're there from 9 to 5 or 8 to 4, whatever your hours are, and you're paid for every minute you're there at that job. You're paid to go to meetings with your coworkers. You're paid to, you know, if you need to go somewhere to get some research or meet with someone outside the office, you're paid. If you're even just standing around the water cooler with your coworkers, that's where some of the best, most interesting creative ideas come from, right? Water cooler conversation. You're paid for that. You're paid for rest breaks. And, you know, there's just a lot of things that you do that you're paid for the entire time. But with this gig economy work, you're only paid for that moment when you're producing that report, when you're producing that graphic file, when you finish the project. If you have to, you know, have some meetings in order to figure out, you know, how to complete that project, you don't get paid for that. If you need to get some extra training in order to complete that project, you don't get paid for that. You know, it's sort of like, imagine is Russell Wilson, is that his name, the quarterback, the Seahawks? Okay. I did my research, see? It's as if, you know, Russell Wilson only gets paid when he throws a touchdown pass. And all the other plays, he doesn't get paid for that. All the training, he doesn't get paid for that. It's as if a chef in a top restaurant only gets paid by the meal. It's all piecework. It's taking us back to a conception of work that is pre-New Deal. It was like in the 19th century. You're also not paid to look for the next job. You know, even when if you have a gig lined up, it might take you 2 weeks to complete that gig. Well, you need a job lined up for when that gig is over. So you're not paid to look for that. A lot of these workers spend a huge amount of time looking for the next gig. In fact, it's almost a full-time job. It's one of the chief complaints. It's like, I'm always looking for the next job. You're not paid if you show up for a gig with someone, you know, who's paid you to come to their home and do whatever, and they spaced it out, and they're not there. Sorry. You miss out on the wage. You also, as a contractor and a freelancer, you know, in a regular job, you pay your share of Social Security and Medicare. It amounts to about almost 8%. And then the employer pays their half. But as a contractor or freelancer, you now have to pay the employer's half. So that's another almost 8% that comes out of your wage as for these types of workers. And really, when you start putting it all together, a lot of the workers say initially, I like the flexibility. And sure, having a flexible work schedule is a beautiful thing. But on the other hand, when you're constantly running from job to job and the jobs don't always pay that much, you don't have any safety net, you know, you're paying your own Social Security, Medicare, you gotta, you don't have access to an organization that has resources, you don't have the support of a team, all these sorts of things suddenly are on you. That's why, Leah Busk from TaskRabbit and some of these others, they like to say, you're the CEO of your own business, right? Well, last time I looked, most CEOs aren't making barely minimum wage, and they actually make sure they have their own safety net, and they have a lot of other things that these workers just don't have. And so, this is a pretty radical reconceptualization of what we think of as work in this country, that somehow this would be an okay thing to be going from gig to gig, piecework to piecework, that you'd be the CEO of your own business and somehow think that there aren't going to be some real knock-on effects to not only what happens to that individual, but to their families who depend on that income. I mean, you don't know from month to month how much you're going to make for a lot of these workers. You can't even count on it. So I really think we have to think more thoroughly about this, whether this is going to be a good replacement for the types of jobs we had in this country for decades. The types of jobs that came out of the New Deal and had safety nets and had some degree of job security. Because, the other component of this is what happens to the broader macro economy. Our economy is built 70% on consumer spending. That's what drives our economy. Well, if not enough people have enough money in their pockets to buy up all the goods and services that the businesses are producing, what happens? The economy starts having ongoing recessionary pressures pulling it down. So this is, could be particularly jarring to what we think of as the middle class, the American dream, which has, has been one of the main selling points of the glory of America to the world. The world, people try to come here to get a piece of that American dream. And so we're just letting this sort of fritter away in many ways and not realizing that it's not just going to affect our economy, but it's going to affect our geopolitical standing in the world to let this go. You all are looking a little depressed right now. But we shall carry on. So let's look at just a few of these companies, some who you have heard of before, Uber and Airbnb. You've had a little experience with those companies here in Seattle, so are we in San Francisco. Uber is a rather interesting company. It really, I think, has revealed something about Americans, that this company has gotten as far as it has, breaking all sorts of laws, not paying its taxes, and strictly because, granted, taxi industry is not very good. I live in San Francisco, the neighborhood I live in out near the beach, it could take 35, 40 minutes for a taxi to show up. So I totally understand what that's about. But here's the thing. You can't just have a company whose stated mission is to flood the streets with their cars and drivers in order to, they're in a competitive battle with taxis, with their ride-sharing competitors, Lyft, Sidecar, and others. Travis Kalanick's stated mission is to flood the streets with cars. You can't just expect that that's going to happen and not end up with other impacts such as congestion. Have you noticed the traffic is getting worse in Seattle? As in San Francisco, as in Los Angeles, even more in Los Angeles, New York City? I mean, Uber represents America's big fantasy, that we can all have our own private chauffeur that shows up to pick us up whenever we want, and we don't have to pay very much for it. And yet, we're going to choke on our convenience, because it's great when you hit that app and Uber shows up in 5, 10, or 15 minutes compared to a taxi. But what happens when you get in that car and now you're sitting in traffic 15, 20, 25 minutes longer because there's so many ride-sharing cars on the road? I mean, the traffic in Seattle isn't only caused by ride-sharing, but Uber claims it has 10,000 drivers in Seattle. They're not all driving at the same time, obviously, but, you know, several thousand of them could possibly be, especially during busy times, rush hour and what have you. I mean, how could you not just throw a few thousand cars on the roads and not expect that you're going to have increased congestion, increased carbon monoxide? There goes your goals for climate change, right? This is what's happening to your streets. This is what's happening in San Francisco, where I live. The traffic has become brutal. And everybody is complaining about it, everybody is talking about it, and somehow they're not connecting it to we have this company who's decided to flood your streets with cars so that you don't have to wait very long and so that they can beat taxi and they can beat us a Lyft in the competition that they're in with them. You really have to think of your streets as a public utility. And you have to think of, you know, you have all these different types of vehicles. I mean, I think ride sharing is here to stay. I think actually with the right regulations, we could make this technology work. In Finland, they've taken the Uber tracking technology and they put it into public shuttles. And you get into the shuttle and you tell the driver where you want to go, and there's other passengers in the van that have done the same thing, and the driver can plot a course in real time using the technology. They don't have to follow a specific bus route. And so, you know, it's like having a van pool in the public transit system. These are the types of things that we can do with this technology if we think of our streets as a public utility. If you start having things like congestion zones, like they have in London, where, you know, at a certain time of day, you could put quotas about how many types of vehicles can be in downtown if that's where the traffic problems are. You know, you can have a certain amount that are public vehicles of, you know, people like yourselves who are driving, certain amount ride sharing, certain amount of taxis, certain amount of trucks making deliveries. And you can track all these vehicles and make sure that your streets aren't going to just become flooded with the cars of this one company who's decided that, you know, they're going to make a lot of money by making you wait less time for a taxi type ride. So there's huge environmental impacts. I mean, incredibly to me, Travis Kalanick runs around saying Uber is good for the environment, you know, because you're all going to leave your cars home and you're going to quit driving your cars and maybe even get rid of your cars, and you're just going to use his service when he has the monopoly that he wants. I mean, nothing frightens me more than the idea of leaving the entire public transit system in the hands of Travis Kalanick. Think about it also from the standpoint of public transit. The way a public transportation system works is you have certain bus lines that are the busy ones. They make the money. They're profitable because a lot of people use them. Those ones subsidize the other bus lines that don't have as many people and that don't make money. And if you're going to have a comprehensive public transit system, you have to have both kinds of lines. You can't just have the profitable ones. Well, what happens if Travis Kalanick decides, you know what, we're just going to send drivers up and down the busy, profitable routes, and we're just going to poach passengers from them? In fact, he's already created a service called Uber Pool that wants to do just that. So this is going to drain money from your public transit system. They've done studies, as you can imagine, of who's using Uber, what kind of people. And what the studies are showing is that 50% of the people using Uber, if they didn't have Uber to use, instead, they would use public transit, they would bicycle, or they would walk. So how can we possibly think that this company is going to somehow be green when the people who are getting into a car belching carbon monoxide are not using other greener forms of transportation instead? It's just not real world. So that's the environmental things. Let's talk about the labor issues of Uber for a little bit. Travis Kalanick was running around for a while saying that, let me just do a time check here, his drivers, full-time drivers, were making $100,000 per year. I mean, it didn't pass the laugh test, and yet the Washington Post and all these other outlets were just, you know, it was like reporting it off the Uber press release. And then, you know, somebody started riding with these riders and asking them for pay stubs. And there's a whole trajectory. There was a report put out by Uber, the Alan Krueger report. He's a Princeton economist, a very renowned economist. And somehow he put his name on this report that all relied on Uber data. And, you know, Uber, I mean, relying on Uber's data is like letting the tobacco companies do their own tests. This company plays fast and loose with the facts, like saying their drivers are making $100,000 per year. So they rode with some of these drivers. And lo and behold, they're not making any more than taxi companies. Some of them are saying actually they're not even making minimum wage after you subtract their considerable costs for driving. Imagine making a living driving and the cost to your car and how your car gets beat up. It doesn't last as long. You know, they're having to replace their cars much quicker as a result of driving for this platform. The Krueger report actually came out with a number saying drivers were making anywhere from $17 to $30 per hour, depending on the city. And so when you start doing the math, it's like, okay, well then, so that means they'd have to be riding like 10 hours a day, 365 days a year, in order to make $100,000. So their own report killed the first Uber myth. But then on top of that, as I said, when you start adding in the driver's expenses, you have to subtract that. In this particular Krueger report, which again was reported by the media at face value, they didn't do a whole lot of analysis of it. It turns out that they collected the data in October of 2014. They released the report in January of 2015 in time for the conference of mayors, trying to impress all these mayors about, you know, all these middle-class jobs they were creating. And then 2 weeks after that conference, they cut the driver's wages in 48 cities. By 40%. This was not the first time that they had cut the driver's wages. They cut the driver's wages in two ways. One, they decreased the amount per mile that the drivers receive, and then they increased the amount that Uber takes of every fare. When Uber first started out, they were taking 5% of every fare. Now they're up to 25 to 30%, depending on the city, the type of service, Uber service that you get, and these sorts of things. So they are squeezing the drivers in two ways, and you know, they're doing it because they're in a price war with taxi and Lyft, and they're mounting this tax, this price war on the backs of the drivers. This is absolutely clear. Now, that Krueger report actually, I think you have to be really suspect with Uber data, but you can be sure that the data they tell you is the best that it is, right? So it's, that report showed that 80% of Uber drivers were part-time, about half were driving 15 hours or fewer, and about half of them only lasted a year on the platform. And after a year, they left because they got tired of putting up with Uber and its price cuts and its wage cuts and all these sorts of things. And, you know, a lot of people say to me, you know, I talked to my Uber driver, and he says he likes it pretty good. And what I say back is ask that driver how long he's been driving for Uber, because the clear pattern that you see is that the longer you've been driving for Uber and the more hours per week you drive for Uber, the less you like it. And that's telling. I mean, if these jobs were such good jobs and paid so much, why would drivers be leaving it after a year? And why would they drive it only a few hours a week? You know, it just doesn't add up with some of the things they say. Now, I know David Plouffe was here before. You know, David Plouffe, just recently he was here, and he's the former campaign manager for Barack Obama in 2008. He's a very high-profile, tied into the top establishment Democrat. And he's now the chief PR flack for Uber. So he came here to speak against the Seattle City Council proposal that would create a quasi way for these drivers to have collective bargain, because these drivers are contractors, so they don't have a safety net, they don't have health care, there's no job security, you can be cut off this platform at any time. So they can't, contractors aren't allowed by law to form a union. So the law is doing some creative things to try and give them some collective bargaining rights. So here's a top Democrat who came here with an anti-labor stance to speak against a collective bargaining bill. Think about that. In the middle of a presidential election, this is a battle for the soul of the Democratic Party, in my view, because the Democrats, they may not have always followed through on their convictions and their statements about being pro-labor, but they at least were pro-labor. And now we have a top Democrat who's speaking against a collective bargaining bill. That is, to me, is something that needs to be watched to see how far that infects into the presidential campaign. Is Hillary Clinton going to adopt this kind of stance? You know, especially, you know, if once she wins the nomination, which I assume she will, though, you know, the Bernie Sanders people are trying very hard. You know, what will happen there? What kind of position will she take for collective bargaining for these sorts of drivers? Now, the drivers are figuring out that, one, they can be cut off this platform at any time. I mean, there is flexibility. That's one of the things that drivers say they like about driving for Uber. You can do it when you want. But here's the thing. It's not so clear cut. Just recently, 350 drivers in Los Angeles were cut off the platform without notice. Just taken right off. Why? Because their acceptance rate was too low. Their acceptance of accepting rides that when they get pinged by a passenger, they say no. Why were they accepting so few rides? They were only accepting about 50%. Because a lot of the rides are for very short rides, for a mile or two. And when the street's so congested, you're sitting in traffic for 15, 20 minutes to go a mile or two, and you know you're not going to make any money on that ride. So you know, someone pings you, you just say no. Now, if these drivers truly are the CEOs of their own driver's business, as Travis Kalanick and the sharing economy leaders try to say, that these are your CEOs of their own business. If you're really the CEO of your own driving business and you can't refuse a ride that you know is going to lose you money, what's the point of being a CEO of that business? You know, and so the idea that somehow Uber is not an employer, which is the legal issue at question, and there's a lawsuit now, a class action lawsuit about a bunch of Uber drivers that will be heard in the federal courts in next June. The standard is how much control you exert over those workers. And here's a company that is cutting them off the platform, basically firing them because they're not accepting rides that they're going to lose money on. That to me says this is an employer. Whether they'll win that lawsuit, I don't know. But you know, these are the types of things that I hope the court will look at. The drivers are figuring out that they only make money during surge pricing. How many people here have heard of surge pricing? A few hands. With Uber and ride sharing, they have this mechanism where when the demand for rides is high, and there's not enough drivers on the street, the price can shoot up 2, 3, 4, 5, as high as 10 times I've seen. And so people who take an Uber early in the evening, you know, they pay $20, $25 for a ride. When they come back later in the evening for the exact same ride, they're paying $250 for that same ride. And they didn't realize it. You know, sometimes the drivers don't even know it, and they're apologetic, like, I'm sorry, I don't know why the ride is so much. You know, take it up with Uber. Good luck with that. You know, you can't get anyone on the phone. You just email them, and maybe they'll respond. You know, customer service is not their forte. And so, you know, some of this surge pricing happens, for example, during Hurricane Sandy. You know, people were trying to flee lower Manhattan because the surge of water that was coming. And suddenly the price of an Uber goes up 8, 9 times. Well, that's actually called price gouging. It's actually illegal to do that in the middle of a crisis. And the Attorney General of New York really went after them. In Sydney, Australia, someone who went berserk in a cafe, took hostages, they had guns, people getting shot. Suddenly the price of an Uber jumped to $100 in Australia as people were trying to flee. Now, apparently Uber has now realized that this is terrible for public relations. And so they have sort of reined that in a little bit, at least during the crises and during emergencies. But during like holidays, New Year's Eve, and all these sorts of things, it's in full mode. And so the drivers are figuring out, we only make money during this surge pricing thing. So how do we manipulate this thing? So like drivers in San Diego, they started getting together, about 60 of them, at a Pizza Hut on a Saturday night. And they all log into the app, so the algorithm thinks, okay, well, this is how many drivers we've got on the app, and that's on the platform, and they figure out the price. And then they all order pizza and beer, and they log off, creating an artificial shortage of drivers. And they wait a certain amount of time while they're eating their pizza and beer. The algorithm shoots up, the price surges, and then they go back out and drive, and you, the customers, pay for this price surge. This is, you know, what the drivers are doing, understandably, because they're not making money unless they do these sorts of things. So, you know, I mean, I could talk forever about Uber. The background checks are inadequate. The lack of insurance for these drivers. They don't have the standards of the taxi industry. I mean, say what you want about the taxi industry and the poor service, but there's a lot of regulation around those companies. And a regulation that has been crafted over many years in order to protect you, the consumer. And suddenly this new ride-sharing industry is not being held to the same standard. I just don't understand it. I mean, you know, you go overseas, you go to France, for example, and they look at Uber, and they say, this is a taxi company. We don't care that you connect the drivers and the passengers in some new fangled way. You know, you're not a technology company, even though Uber changed its name, its original name, to Uber Technologies. You're a taxi company, and you must follow the same rules as the taxi industry here in France. The two heads of Uber in France are sitting in jail right now awaiting trial because they've broken the law so many times, and Uber just tells the drivers, just keep driving, we'll pay your fines, we'll pay if your car gets impounded. They just keep breaking the law. And they're doing this in country after country. In South Korea, there's a warrant out for the arrest of Travis Kalanick if he steps foot in the country for breaking these laws. I mean, the rest of the world looks at this company and they say, it's a taxi company. It's only here in the United States where we're like, oh my God, what is it? What do we do with this thing? How do we regulate this thing? Is it technology? Is it a taxi? Is it some new flying saucer? What is this thing? How do we regulate it? And so I mean, we've made this thing so complicated that now we have two different sets of laws for the same basic service. I mean, there was a time when taxis didn't have meters in them. And then when they put meters in, did that make them a technology company? No, they were still a taxi company, still providing a safe service. So why Seattle, San Francisco, city after city, doesn't just simply say, you need to follow the laws of taxis? I don't understand. Or, if you're not going to do that, then remove the regulations off taxis. Because, I mean, on the flip side, I don't know why taxi companies and drivers here have just taken it, in my view, just kind of lying down. I mean, in France, they burn tires in the streets. They, you know, they do all sorts of protests to prevent this. They, you know, and that's what makes the public officials pay more attention and throw the heads of Uber in jail. Because, you know, there's consequences if they don't. But here in the U.S., even though taxis and the medallion system is being extremely devalued, I don't know why the owners of medallions aren't suing Seattle for not enforcing its laws and devaluing the value of that medallion, because that's exactly what's going on. But for some reason, you know, everybody here is just going passive around these things. Uber also doesn't pay taxes, the livery taxes that taxi companies have to pay, on and on and on. I'm going to move on from Uber. We could talk more about it. I want to say that I understand that it's awfully darn convenient to hit that app and have that car show up. You know, a lot of people think that app is beautiful. Wow. But you know what? That's not what's beautiful about Uber. That's not what is innovative. Because if you were hitting that app and the car was taking 45 minutes to show up, you wouldn't be so thrilled with that app. You would be rather frustrated, like, God, it's still stuck down in Ravenna and 65th. Where the heck, when is that car going to get here? What's innovative about Uber is they flooded your streets with cars. That's what you have to remember. That's what makes it possible for that car to show up in just a few minutes, because there's so many drivers buzzing around trying to make some money. That's all it is. The app is an add-on. Let's talk about Airbnb a little bit. Airbnb is a good example of a company, of a service that started out as a good idea. The idea that, someone has a spare room in their home, they want to rent it out, make some extra money, and in the middle of a bad economy, you know, seems like a pretty good idea. What could be wrong with that? I haven't met too many people who, you know, weren't supportive of that. But that's not what Airbnb is anymore. It has morphed drastically as a company. It has become a company, a service that has been completely invaded by professional real estate operatives. Those professional real estate operatives are taking over that platform, using it to break laws, to get around laws. Most cities have had laws on the books for many, many years saying you can't rent out your home, your house, your property for less than 30 days. The reason why you have laws like that on the books is to prevent your housing stock, which is where local people have to live, right? You don't want your housing stock to suddenly be rented out to tourists, because there's going to be no place for the locals to live. So that's why they put those laws in place. Now, along comes a service like Craigslist, some others. It allowed these laws to be broken a little bit, but it was happening at a level that was small enough that you really didn't have to worry too much about it dangerously hurting your housing stock. Now along comes Airbnb and rips a giant loophole in the law because it allows professionals to rent out their homes, rent out their buildings rather, and not get caught because it's happening at such a massive level that it floods the ability of city officials to track it. And that's what's going on. What do I mean by professional real estate operatives? Well, you know, in San Francisco, for example, I've interviewed a lot of people who are in the book, and you know, this one apartment building, four units, and the owner of the building was 96 years old. She actually lived in the building, and everyone in the building got along really well. It was a community. This part of San Francisco I'm thinking of is called North Beach. It's also Little Italy, the old Italian communities, the old Fisher communities that used to live there, and lived in these apartments for decades. Rent-controlled apartments, a lot of the people in there, seniors, disabled people in some of these apartments. So the owner dies, wills it to her niece in Southern California. The niece immediately issues evictions for everyone in the building. Get out. She's invoking a loophole called owner-occupied move-in. You know, she's going to move into the building and not be in the rental business anymore. And that's one of the, you know, that's one of the reasons you can evict people. You know, so basically she's saying, I'm going to move up from Southern California into this building. Well, you can't live in all four units. Well, I have some family members from other parts of the country, and they are going to move into the other units. You know, and so by the time, you know, that's what she's saying. You can't prove she's wrong. And by the time you realize it's not happening, the tenants are gone. No one's there to monitor the building, see if they actually do that. So they evict everyone in the building, and they turn it into an Airbnb tourist hotel. And on one street, there were six buildings in which everyone in the building had been evicted. One of those buildings, you know, you can see outside the four doors, lockboxes, telltale sign that that building has been Airbnb'd. Because, you know, you go on the website, the anonymous website, you make your reservation, you show up at the address, you let yourself in with the key in the lockbox, you stay there, when you leave, you put the key back in the lockbox. There goes your community. There goes, I mean, that building that had the four lockboxes used to have four families in every one of those units. They're all gone now. It's just Pete tourists coming and going, pulling their rollaway suitcases through the alleys of North Beach. This is happening in building after building throughout the city. Another type of professional is property managers. You have people now who are buying houses in San Francisco. They have no intention of living in these houses or renting them out to locals. They're going to rent them to tourists. There was a leaked Coldwell Banker memo that it was basically a memo to people in the real estate industry saying, according to our studies, if you rent your property out on Airbnb rather than to a local resident, you can double your revenue. That's the profit incentive that we're talking about here. So these property managers are managing the properties of absentee owners and just renting them out on Airbnb. There goes your housing stock. Now, it's true, as Airbnb will say, hey, look, we're not the cause of the affordability crisis in Seattle or San Francisco. It's true, there's many causes for that. But when you have a city like Seattle and San Francisco where the vacancy rate is, you know, maybe 2 to 3%, and you have Airbnb that has, in the case of Seattle, about 3,500 homes on its platform, in San Francisco, twice that many, in New York City, 25 to 30,000 homes on its platform. Those homes are eating into the small number of vacancies. They are literally the straw that is breaking the camel's back in terms of creating the affordability crisis or adding to the affordability crisis. In Seattle, Airbnb recently, they're on a publicity blitz right now. They just did it in New York. They released the same, they're saying now we're sharing our data, you know, their cherry-picked data. And they're trying to say in Seattle, 80% of the whole homes that are being rented are from people who are living in those homes. But there are other people that go to the Airbnb website, and they can do what's called scraping the website. They can suck the data off that website, and they can do their own analyses. And they say, uh-uh, that's not who's on your platform. In fact, in Seattle, 40% of the listings of the hosts have multiple listings. One listing in Seattle has 58 listings. One host has 58 listings. About half of the revenue from Airbnb is coming from hosts that have multiple properties. And so, you know, it is true that there are the quote regular people, as Airbnb likes to call them, who are benefiting from this platform. But it's also true that the professionals are on there in a major, major way. And here's the thing, Airbnb knows it, because they have access to their data more than anybody. And with one swipe of the computer mouse, they could say, uh-uh, you're renting out multiple properties, you can't do it on our platform. They could take those people right off the platform. They can take off the hosts in New York City that have over 200 properties. But they don't. Why? Obvious. It's money. It's profit. They're a venture capital funded startup. They're, you know, desperate for market share. They're trying to spread around the world. They're heading towards their IPO. They want to blow this thing open to something that's bigger than Facebook. And in order to do that, you know, they're not going to stop that steamroller for a few. You know, one of the guys in this building that I talked about earlier in San Francisco, he had advanced stage of Parkinson's disease, and he got evicted. They don't care about that. Chinatown, language minority people getting evicted. The landlords are using what's called nuisance evictions in Chinatown. They were trying to evict people because they were hanging their laundry outside on their balconies. These are the types of excuses they're using. They use excuses like, we're going to rehabilitate your building. We're really sorry, but you have to get out. Here's a couple thousand dollars to get on your way. These are rent-controlled apartments. They'll never find a place in San Francisco at that rent. They have to move out of the city. But what they don't even tell the tenants, and again, these are, a lot of them are seniors, disabled, language-challenged tenants. By law, you're allowed to move back into the building once the rehab is finished at the rent you were at when you were kicked out. So, I mean, the landlords are showing no shame. Airbnb is showing no shame. Airbnb could get rid of these sorts of people off the platform. It's obvious who they are. In San Francisco, there's actually a law, and Portland, too, where the hosts, by law, have to register with the city. And even though that's the law, only 10% of the hosts in San Francisco have registered. Airbnb could say to the hosts, look, there's a law here, folks. You got to register. If you don't do it, you can't be on our platform. Just that simple. Nope, they don't do it. I mean, the Airbnb website is a virtual advertisement for criminality. That's what it is. Because in San Francisco, 90% of those listings are illegal. And unfortunately, in San Francisco, there is a mayoral administration who's very tech enamored, shall we say. One of his chief financial backers is a Silicon Valley venture capital billionaire who happens to be a major investor in Airbnb. So the tentacles of venture capital has reached into City Hall, and so there's virtually no enforcement, even though they try to say, oh, we're working as hard as we can, we just don't have the resources. Now, it is true that without the data from Airbnb, it's very hard to enforce any of these laws. And that's where, you know, Airbnb's absolute refusal to give up the data, again, it shows, I mean, you know, they like, incredibly, they say, we're a sharing economy, we're the trust and belonging company. I mean, Brian Chesky, the CEO, has got all these little speeches he likes to give about, he said at one point, we're like the blue helmets, you know, of UN. We arrive to save people, we're saving the middle class. David Plouffe for Uber has also said, we're saving the middle class. And yet, the really easy things they could do to really make this platform work for the regular people and to kick off the professionals, they're not willing to do. That's who this company is. That's why I call these companies the share the crumbs economy, not the sharing economy. Here's the other thing that's really beautiful. You know, Airbnb also doesn't pay its hotel and occupancy taxes. They haven't, they've just started paying it. They'll tell you they're in 34,000 cities around the world. They're now paying taxes in about 12 of those cities. San Francisco is now one of them. It was clearly, there was steam building behind a popular effort to rein in Airbnb, and it actually resulted in a ballot measure this past November, Proposition F, that lost after Airbnb spent $10 million to defeat it. It's the most money that's ever been spent in a local election in San Francisco. So Airbnb will say, look, we're the trust and belonging company. We really do want to be regulated. We really want to pay our taxes. But, we're in 34,000 cities, and there's so many laws, and it's just, it's going to take time to figure out all the local laws and all these sorts of things, but we are going to get to it. We promise. Well, at the rate they're going, it's going to take them about 60 years to get to those 34,000 companies. But here's the thing. Let's say you're a DuPont, and you want to set up a chemical plant out near Seattle. Or let's say you're Boeing, and you want to move from Seattle to Chicago. Or, you're Microsoft, and you want to open up a facility somewhere else. You can't open up that facility and tell the local government, we'll figure out the taxes that we owe you later on. We'll figure out the local regulations later on when we've had a chance to do it. I mean, Airbnb and Uber are asserting this new corporate right to start operating first and figure out the details as they go along. I mean, just imagine what it would be like if all these corporations did that. I mean, how can we let these companies just get away with this because they say, we're technology? I mean, are Americans so infatuated with technology that we are just turning a blind eye to what's happening beneath our noses? It appears so. I mean, some of it, I think, is that these companies are still new, and people are figuring out what, beyond the convenience they give us, what are the downsides? And so, hopefully my talk tonight and the book and some other things will help us to figure out these impacts in a way that will help us figure out, how can we regulate this? Because I do believe that, at the core of Airbnb, of Uber and these other things, there is something good, but you have to put the right regulations around. I mean, it's an old story. There were always corporations doing good, initially who did a combination of good and bad things, and then you have to regulate them to get the good and get rid of the bad. It's an old story, but these companies seem to have a particular ethos about them, calling government broken, and these laws are old. I mean, I should say this is kind of funny too. I'm actually an Airbnb host, and I saw an interview between Brian Chesky, the CEO, and Katie Couric, and she was asking him about things like fire and safety and other things having to do with Airbnb, and he said, "Oh, we've got 200 people who I've hired to look after these sorts of things and make sure everything is going to be safe." And she said, "Well, what about fire codes and things like this?" And he's like, "Oh, those laws are so 19th century. I mean, this is the new economy where we have self-rating systems. And the self-rating system between the hosts and the people staying there, that's what's allowing us to regulate. You don't want to put government regulation around this because we can use the rating systems to self-regulate." So I thought, well, let me try this out. Let's see what it's like to become an Airbnb host. So I got on my computer. I took photos of my house inside and out. Within 15 minutes, I was live as an Airbnb host. No contact from these 200 fire and safety people. No even attempt to contact me and say, "Are you sure your house isn't going to burn down?" Nothing. It was just, I was both impressed and appalled that it was so darn easy. I mean, I could have put photos from Better Homes and Garden on my, on there saying, "That's what my house looks like." I could have put a castle in Scotland and said, "This is my home," until somebody stayed there and reported, like, "It's actually not what it's all cracked up to be, folks." How would they know? I mean, I could have been Jack the Ripper. How would they know? They don't. They just trust that the rating system will take care of it. So in addition to when Katie Couric was asking about fire codes and stuff, he said, "We don't need any of that, Katie, because you know what we do? We have, besides the self-rating system, we give all of our hosts a free smoke and carbon monoxide alarm." I was like, "Wow, that sounds pretty cool. I don't..." So I get on my computer and try to order my fire and smoke, my smoke and carbon monoxide alarm, and they send me to a website, and I click on the link, and that sends me to an email to someone over here, and they send me over there. Long story short, there was no smoke and carbon monoxide alarm. Instead, what they said was, "We've run out, but what we will send you is a card that you can write escape routes for your guests in case of a fire, and you can tell them how to call the fire department, and you can..." So, this was the 21st century version of fire and safety codes a la Airbnb. you know, it's just a tragedy waiting to happen. And in fact, these tragedies have already happened. Just recently, there was a young man who wrote about, and this was someone who loved Airbnb, stayed in it many times. His family booked an Airbnb, and there was a swing set tied to the tree, a tree. And the father got on the swing set, thought, oh, I'll give it a try. You know, family's having a good time. It was, turned out to be a rotten tree. The branch broke, came down, hit him on the head, killed him instantly. Airbnb said, wow, we're really sorry about that. But you know what? We are just a technology company setting up a medium between you, who's the renter, and the person renting it. We have no liability here. This has happened. Another fellow rented out an Airbnb. Turned out there was a dog there. The host never said anything about a dog, a Rottweiler. The dog completely mangled his arm. You know, stripped the skin right off. He had to go to the hospital. He had to have plastic surgery eventually. Airbnb again said, we're really sorry about that. We feel badly. But that we can find nothing in our terms of agreement that allows us to assume liability in this situation. Until this person contacted the New York Times, who started writing about it, and suddenly Airbnb found something in their terms of agreement to assume liability for this guy's medical bills. Uber also has had trouble in this regard. You know, and they do their background checks. They say it's the best in the industry. And a matter of fact, the district attorneys of San Francisco and Los Angeles are suing Uber because they charge you, the passengers, $2. It used to be $1, now it's $2, for every ride as a safety fee to fund the background checks. And they say they're the best in the industry, but in fact, they don't do fingerprinting. That's considered the gold standard in background checks. They refuse to do it. Taxi companies do fingerprinting for the most part. They don't do that. And they say it's not necessary. And a couple years ago, on New Year's Eve in San Francisco, there was a driver who took a right-hand turn into a crosswalk, plowed over a family, killed a 6-year-old girl, Sophia Liu, badly injured her 8-year-old brother and her mother. Airbnb immediately said, we're really sorry, it's a horrible tragedy, but we have no liability here. This driver is a CEO of his own driving business, and he is the one who is responsible. Now think about this. You order a pizza from Pizza Hut, that driver is covered by commercial insurance from the moment he or she gets in that car, delivers your pizza, and gets back to the restaurant. Completely covered. Uber, you don't know what kind of coverage they have. Some states have started implementing some programs of insurance. It's not clear what anything covers. And here's the thing. The driver of that car that killed Sophia Liu, he had been arrested in Florida for reckless endangerment with a car for going 100 miles per hour on a city street trying to pass someone. And Uber's background check failed to come up with that. So with that cheery note, let's turn it over to you for your questions and comments. Yeah, I could go on, but I get the idea.
My name's Wade.
Hey, Wade.
I just retired from King County Metro, so I drive for a transit company. And I have two questions. First one is, have you ever met Barbara Ehrenreich?
I haven't met her, but I certainly know who she is. Second question?
It would be really nice to have both of you on talking about the old economy and the new economy.
Yeah.
The second question is, do you think it's time to completely overhaul the whole entire economic system?
Well, okay. Let's get a couple questions here because they might overlap. Somebody, go ahead.
Yeah, my name's Bill Graff. Kind of difficult listening to you vilify Airbnb, in that I'm an Airbnb host, and I've been for years I've been like dreaming about having my own like kind of hotel like kind of thing with a property that I can rent out short term to people, mm-hmm. and I spent a lot of time trying to create a wonderful environment, and I've been doing this for like about 6 years. And I have great people come in. There, a lot of people are people like my own age, generally parents coming in to visit their kids, and they appreciate the place. and they appreciate the environment. It seems to add nicely to the environment of the city, and is, it provides a nice place for, so you don't have to like step out of your hotel room and see another Anthropology or Hugo Boss or something like that. The question is at 70 years old, are you suggesting that maybe I should stop this, put my inventory on the market for an Amazon employee, and try and get a job in a hotel?
Okay, any other people want to put their questions on the stack? And thanks for your question. It's a good question.
So my question is, what's stopping the taxi, the yellow cabs of the world, or the Marriotts of the world to go after Airbnb or Uber?
Okay, so overhaul in the economic system sounds great, but it's kind of hard to do. So, you know, I mean, I do have two chapters of solutions that if we pass them all, it would amount to a pretty good overhaul of the system. So, you know, I think that we should do more to think about, you know, I mean, there's no question that capitalism is the greatest wealth generator that humans have ever devised. But there's a question there, who gets the wealth? Whose pockets does it go into, right? And so what I think our challenge is going forward is figuring out how to harness this capitalist engine, this great wealth generator, in a way that's going to work for the next 50 years. Because with these new technologies that are coming online, and I haven't even talked, I have a whole chapter in the book about robots and automation and artificial intelligence and all this kind of stuff. There's some very dramatic changes that are coming. And if we don't think these things through, my real fear is that we're going to look back 20, 25 years from now, and we're going to say, wow, we did not get that right. We did not think it through. We just fell for really easy answers like, you know, my Uber driver says he likes driving just fine. And, you know, and as a result of this, we didn't put in the right regulations. So I think we have to really think about these a little more deeply. I mean, again, I don't know how many properties you rent. Five? And are they all in your one house, or are there several different homes, or?
I have one small apartment building that I've owned for over 20 years. Okay. And then I have a house that I converted
to the basement of my house. Okay, so you have one, people could hear he had one apartment building that has multiple units, and he has a home that he's also renting. I mean, it's your property, it's your right to do with it what you want, but you know what? The thing I would suggest to you is that every city has limited housing stock. There's limited space. You can't just keep building, unless you're going to become like Hong Kong and build to the sky, you have limited housing stock. So for every unit you're taking off the rental market for locals because you're renting it to tourists, that's driving up everyone else's rent. When you're doing it and he's doing it and she's doing it and all these people are doing it around the city.
So I should go to work for a hotel? Is that what you're telling me?
I'm just... Well, who's staying in your place? Is it Amazon people too? I mean, you know, it's they're all people that need housing. So, you know, I'm not going to try to solve your retirement issues for you.
Am I supposed to, like, stop what I'm doing?
You have to decide that for yourself. I'm just letting you know that there are consequences for the 3,500 people in Seattle who are doing what you're doing. It is affecting other people. I mean, keep in mind, it's also, I haven't even talked about, you know, people have a reasonable expectation that when they move into a certain neighborhood, that they're not living, moving in next to a hotel. The hotels in the past were zoned into a particular part of the city for a reason, okay? And now suddenly, I don't know what it's like in your place, but I can tell you there's all sorts of stories out there of people who now have constant strangers living next door to them, traipsing in and out, staying up all hours of the night partying because these are people on vacation. They just stay up and party. They call it causing noise in the neighborhoods. Do they have rights too? You have property rights. Do they have rights to be able to enjoy the peace and quiet of their neighborhood?
Six years I've never had a guest like that.
Well, okay, you haven't, but a lot of other people have. A lot of people have. No, that's not what it's about, sir. That is not what it's about. Sorry. But I thank you for your questions, and let's move on. What's stopping the taxis from going after them? I don't know. As I said, I don't know. It seems to me they're very complacent. They haven't used the tools that they have at their means. But I'm sure if there was someone here from the taxi industries, they probably would have a pretty good answer that I'm just not aware of. But I just see what other countries have done, and they haven't just taken it lying down. They are really fighting back. Sometimes, literally, in Mexico City, there have been brawls between taxi drivers and Uber drivers, and I'm not advocating that at all, but I'm just saying some people are really taking it seriously that this newcomer is coming in who doesn't follow the same laws and regulations and are basically eating their seed. That's what's happening. So, yeah.
You've said a lot of convincing things about how sleazy these particular two companies are. I'm more interested in looking at it a little more generally. Do you think that the sharing economy is a concept that's unworkable or necessarily destructive, or are we at an early sort of robber baron stage of it where things will get worked out in terms of public policy and it'll get more more worthwhile? Is there a what's the path ahead, and can this be turned into something positive or not, and can it be controlled or not?
I think it can be controlled. I think with the right regulations, it may be we're in a particular robber baron stage of it. You know, there are sharing economy companies out there that are trying to do the right thing, like Yertl, based in San Francisco, started by Adam Werbach, who used to be I forget his exact title, but he was the head of the Sierra Club board. And Yertl, you know, you can take your stuff and you can put it on the website and you get Yertl currency that then you can spend on other people's stuff. And so it's very much an exchange that isn't really impacting anybody else. There are other companies out there that are really trying to embrace a truly sharing ethos about this without the knock-on effects that it's having to their neighbors and to other people who are being injured by some of these other companies that aren't doing so much. I mean, you know, you have to keep in mind that Uber is a $51 billion company at this point. That's almost as large as General Motors. Even though Uber doesn't make a single car. They don't own a single car. They don't even claim to have any employees except for the 1,000 or so that work in San Francisco running the company. And yet it's worth almost as much as General Motors. It's worth almost as much as Ford. And Airbnb is valued at $25 billion, which is like twice as much as Hilton Hotels. It's more than Hyatt Hotels. These are companies that the investors are trying to, as I said, the venture capital funders are looking to blow these things open into big, huge IPOs. That's what it's about for them. It was in San Francisco in this Prop F campaign, they took out all sorts of TV ads and billboards and everything else. And the face of the company, of course, were the regular people. You know, that's who they said, this is going to get hurt if you pass Proposition F. These people who are making some extra money, let's let them do that. And, you know, that's legitimate. But you didn't see them featuring the ads, the professionals who have taken over this platform and are basically, you know, giving them half of their revenue right now. And as I said, Airbnb knows this. They could stop that. They could let the little person continue and take out these professionals, but they don't do it. So, I think with the right type of regulation, when Seattle goes to regulate this company, it needs to just tell them, look, no, you could set the threshold where you want. You could say, we're going to allow owners to have 4 properties on this platform, no more. Get rid of the people that have 15, 20, 25, 50 properties. And we're going to make you register with the city. And if you don't register with the city, you can't be listed on the Airbnb platform. And if Airbnb lists you, they're going to pay a fine for everyone they register. But then the other key thing, and also they got to pay their taxes, like other hotels have to do, like you and I have to do. And then also the key is the law has to say Airbnb must give us the data. We need to know who's hosting, how many nights, how much. They're renting the rooms out per night. Because here's the thing, even in San Francisco, they're paying about $12 million a year now in taxes. But San Francisco doesn't know if that's the right amount of money. For all they know, they owe them twice as much as that. Airbnb is just saying, like, here's $12 million, now go away, leave us alone, we're not giving you our data. You have to have the data in order to regulate these companies. And the same with, city council's attempt to collective bargain for Uber. You need to have the data, and thankfully the law does require Uber to give up its data. Uber is going to fight that, as we know.
Answer my question.
We just have time for one more question, and then we can continue dialogue on the book signings.
Yeah, so we can just take have two of them real quick in case.
Two more, okay.
I'll stack them, go ahead.
Thinking about your argument, and what's your thought on Airbnb's effect on tourism? I mean, it seems that you're probably getting more tourism than you would because somebody's staying at these Airbnb places. That has all kinds of economic benefits. Presumably then the rental rates for people who would want to rent for less than 30 days goes up, which then creates an incentive to increase housing stock, which is also clearly needed. And so there's all kinds of ancillary economic effects that are created here and possibly were suppressed by suboptimal regulations, which are sort of being eased away. Just what's your thoughts on all these other sort of ancillary benefits and effects that are occurring with the rise of Airbnb specifically?
Okay. Was there another? Go ahead.
I think the overall thing which you're pointing out, to America and the government itself has not invested in its people. I drive Uber. I have a dual master's and I have a dual engineering degree. And I have to drive to survive. So it's not that you don't have unintelligent people, people who have dreams. They hadn't been invested in by our society. So they have to survive. Whether they drove the cab or Uber or did the Airbnb, how do you utilize the talent and the knowledge of the American people to make it work for society? And that is the problem, and it has always been a problem.
Right.
And that is the question. We need to invest in us.
Right. It's a good segue for me to talk about just a couple of the solutions in my book. The key one is, most people have, for decades, has gotten their safety net, their benefits and what have you, retirement, healthcare, through their employer. And oftentimes they work for one employer, they would work for that employer for many years, they would work many hours per week. That's how our system was founded in the post-World War II era. But now we're not our system has changed very much, very drastically. More and more workers now have multiple employers, and including employers who don't give you benefits at all, or you have to reach a certain threshold to get those benefits, you never reach the threshold. So we have to come up with a safety net that works in this multi-employer world. And so what I propose in chapter 10 of my book, it's actually getting out there and people are starting to talk about it. There was just a letter signed by 40 business, labor, and NGO leaders endorsing this idea of what's called portable benefits, what we would do is we would require that every business that hires a worker, doesn't matter if they hire a regularly employed worker or a freelancer or a contractor or a temp, doesn't matter. You hire someone, you pay a certain amount of money beyond the wage into an individual security account for that worker. And the amount that that business pays will be prorated to the number of hours that worker works for that business. And then those funds would be used by that worker to pay for their safety net. Some of it would go to existing safety net infrastructure, so Social Security, Medicare, injured worker compensation, unemployment compensation, health care. In the plan that I've devised using Bureau of Labor Statistics numbers, it would cost anywhere from about $2 to $2.50 per hour above the wage for service sector workers to give them all of that plus about 5 days paid vacation and paid sick leave. That's not a lot of money to give all these workers some type of safety net that many of them don't have now. And so Uber drivers, Uber would hire you. They would they would have to pay into your individual security account based on how much earnings you have in the case of Uber. A certain amount prorated to the amount of earnings that you have from Uber that would pay for your safety net. Any of these employers would have to do that kind of thing. If we did this, that would, in some degree, let this new economy go forward and let some of the best parts be in effect and get rid of some of the worst impacts that we're seeing. I mean, some workers today, you know, they stay in a job because they have health care. They don't necessarily like the job anymore, but they have good health care, they have a family, they can't afford to leave, or they have a retirement pension, they don't want to leave, even though they don't like the job anymore. You know, that kind of job lock is not good for the economy either. So by having a plan like this, where we have portable benefits, portable safety net, is tied to you, the worker, you take it with you from job to job, from employer to employer, that really is the wave of the future, in my view. That's the type of system we have to transition to. This is what, you know, most other developed economies in the world already do. You know, in Europe and Canada and other places, they don't treat part-timers, freelancers, contractors, temps so differently from how they treat full-time, regularly employed workers, other than working more, you know, different amount of hours, and maybe the wages are higher for the regularly employed full-timers. But in terms of the safety net, they're treated, you know, they can't, by law, they can't treat them quite so differently. And the U.S. is kind of the outlier in this kind of way. And if we're really going to make this new economy work, we're going to have to transition to that type of system. I also propose things like more vocational training and job rehabilitation. We spend way less money compared to many other countries in the world in terms of percentage of GDP on these sorts of things. We also should start doing more job sharing. You know, other countries are starting to allow people to work less than full time and still get full benefits, because of they have this, you know, portable safety net system, and still make a decent wage. And then that you share the job so that more people can be employed instead of having, you know, some people who are ultra employed and others who are underemployed. One of the other things I propose is what's called co-determination. You know, in Germany, for example, they have major corporations, obviously, names of companies you've heard of like Daimler and Mercedes and Volkswagen. But Siemens, you know, they have Fortune 500 companies there. And we think of, well, they're just corporations like ours. They actually aren't. They're structured quite differently. By law, the workers of these corporations get to elect 50% of the members of the boards of directors of these corporations. I mean, it would be as if we require Walmart to allow its workers to elect 50% of the members of the boards of directors of Walmart. Can you imagine that? I mean, we kind of laugh at the thought. We can't even envision it in the U.S. context. And yet this is what, you know, Germany is the biggest exporter in the world. It's a major economy, and this is what they do. Sweden does this. You know, their economy has done quite well in the aftermath of this Great Recession. Most countries in Europe are doing some version of this co-determination. Now, how many of you, other than those who know me, they don't count, how many of you have heard of co-determination? Just a couple of hands. I mean, how could we not know this, right? This is something that we have to really start learning what other countries are doing, how they're dealing with these pressures of globalization and what have you. And here's the thing. You could actually pass something like this in an NGO or at the University of Washington. I spoke to a bunch of students today. I was trying to get them whipped up for going and pass something like this at University of Washington, where, you know, either the workers or the students or both would get to elect 50% of the members of the boards of trustees. Get it in place in a place like University of Washington that isn't going to fight it as much as some of the businesses, and start getting it in place in different places so that, you know, once you've tried it out, then you can start moving on to the businesses and proposing these things. You know, the city of Seattle could pass the portable benefits plan. You don't have to wait for the state or even the federal government, because, you know, the Republicans in Congress are never going to pass something like this. So you don't have to wait. You can pass a law saying all local businesses have to pay into an individual security account for their workers that will be used to pay for their safety net. These are sorts of things that can be done, and I think we ought to do them, because this is going to help us transition to where we're going. You know, I probably should end it there because I know we're getting late. I apologize, I didn't get to your question, but I'd be happy to talk one-on-one if you'd like. Thank you for having me and for being here.